What's up, everybody? My name is Kason. Welcome back to another War of the Visions video. Today is our WDL Season 2 Draft Recap for the playoffs. So if you guys are unaware, our top four teams of each division ended up making the playoffs, and instead of using their regular season rosters, they actually are using brand new rosters from a brand new 8-person snake draft that we did. But in order to determine the draft order, there were a couple of things that went into this. First of all, the first seed of both Rundahl and Heinler, which is Coppola and McCrane respectively, basically have the first two choices of where in the pick order that they want to be. So they're not necessarily guaranteed first and second pick. You know, if the first person wants first pick and the second person maybe they want eighth pick or something like that, they are allowed that. However, since we had a 1, 2, 3, and 4 seed from two different divisions, we had to have some sort of tiebreaker amongst those two seeds to try and help determine the draft order. So what we decided to do as a group was just have a couple of just kind of exhibition best of one games. So essentially, before we get into the draft recap, that is what you guys are going to see. I am not going to do full team previews as this video is probably going to be fairly lengthy, but just know the matches are going to be starting with the 4 seed, finishing with the 1 seed. So it's going to be Surf Taco versus Dr. Dickhead. It is going to be Sand Rooster versus Turambar, Machin X versus Ram 9, and Coppola versus McCrane. And after that, I will announce what the draft order was based on these matches. I'll go through the roster breakdown. So I'm basically going to look at each playoff team's roster. I'm not going to go through the entire draft pick by pick or round by round. I think that will just be too lengthy, but I will show you guys at least a kind of snapshot of what the draft looked like. And I'll just go over a couple of things. Anyway, this video is probably going to be lengthy, so let's jump into it. I will have timestamps down below. If you guys don't want to watch these exhibition games and just want to get straight into the draft coverage, the timestamp is below and you can check that out. But without any further ado, let's jump up into the game between Surf Taco and Dr. Dickhead. Guys, game number one, on the left side, we have Dr. Dickhead's Foolish Mortals versus the right side, Surf Taco's The Superines in this matchup. And it looks like we've got a Zazan and Little Leela showing. So Dr. Dickhead running his Dark Squad through most of the season. Will we see that again, or does he bust out the Astrius that he used in the final week of the season? On the right side, for Surf Taco, it looks like he's bringing Aerith and Shadow Lynx on ice. Very interesting. So we have not seen much Shadow Lynx on ice this season. And yeah, it looks like Dr. Dickhead is trying to shake things up, going with Astrius and Ibarra right out of the gate, going with the Deep Fortification buff on the entire team. And Dance of the Violet will match it from Shadow Lynx on ice, getting Protect on everyone. This will be really nice going into the physical damage of Astrius and Zazan, as Ibarra is going to pop the Zombie Re-Raise TMR. And she's gonna have to be killed twice here. So, Aerith, what does she go for? I imagine it is the Protective Familiar Magic three hit shield buff on the entire team. So that'll be good to versus Ibarra as well. So honestly, tanking up pretty well, I guess, from Surf Taco's side, as the Little Leela TMR from Zazan gonna get the whole party really, really sped up here. And Resist Magic, that is just going to further increase the bulkiness versus this Ibarra. So to me, I think the big threat is probably the Astrius. Well, we'll see what he can do in this fight here. What does he go for? He's going to go for Indomitability. So he has his Courage and defense Piercing Rate, excuse me, as well as AP Cost Rate down. But Ibarra should be able to find a Limit Break here on Little Leela. This is a single target ability. Should drop Lightning Resist. How well can she tank this up? 1802, my god, she tanked that insanely well. Ibarra might be a little power crap by some units in the game, but she still brings a ton of damage. So the fact that she only took 1800 there is pretty impressive. As the re-raise coming up from Aerith with that 140 upgrade also gives CT up on re-raise. Holy shit, 8000 damage coming out from Shadow Lynx on ice, but Ibarra crucially does not die there and still has a re-raise online. Looks like Zazan can't quite reach for damage, but Astrius does not go for the AoE, he goes for the Limit Break, and this is on the Shadow Lynx on ice, who is just the major carry for Surf Taco's team. I will say Surf Taco is pretty much one main damage dealer and a couple of supportive units. Crystal Tracer comes through for 2367, so can't quite pop her in one hit. Can Little Leela take out Ibarra? She will, but she does have the re-raise. So looking at the turn order, Aerith is probably going to go for a heal, I imagine a Limit Break, but that's going to be followed up by Ibarra immediately after. So how does this go? Healing Wind should be able to find both members here. I mean, Shadow Lynx on ice is really the only one that needs it. We'll get her defense up, and she is healed to full, essentially. Ibarra, I imagine, probably a Wailing Storm. No, it goes per counterman slash, actually. About 3,000 damage. Drops the critical evasion, which can actually boost damage coming out in the later turns here. And ending Axel. Man, I never see this unit. She just brought the pain. Holy shit. Dr. Dickhead's team just got absolutely wrecked. Astraeus, though, is holding on with 17 health in this 1v3. Can he pull it off? Cross destruction. Big AoE. How much damage? Kills the Shadow Lynx on ice. Crystal Tracer comes out and kills Aerith. Oh my god. And he just healed himself about 3,000. And then Crystal Tracer kills little Leela. Holy shit. Did he just heal up from that too? No, I don't think he did. Wow. He healed to 3776. So he healed himself 3,700 damage and got essentially a triple kill, only with the re-raise finally coming back to little Leela. He gets his own counter as she's going to drop his bravery, which is nice, but I think he probably still kills. Can't quite kill in this hit. 1861. Little Leela, how much damage do you have? It's not going to matter. Astraeus is going to lap her. He's going to go next. 1776, and Astraeus with the 1v3. We've seen it before, both this season with Dr. Dickhead in the final week and also from Surf Taco's team in season one. So kind of ironic that Dr. Dickhead takes Surf Taco out with his own season one carry. And actually, this is the map that Surf Taco won the whole thing on season one. And in case I didn't mention this, I'm sure I didn't. For this best of one game, what I did was to try and give a slight edge to the team with the better point total going into this match, which in this case would be Surf Taco. He had more total points. I basically said, hey, Surf Taco, you can either choose to play on the Week 9 map if you want, which is Plains 4, or you can choose three maps of your choosing and have the opponent pick one of those three maps to play on. So this is one of the three maps that Surf Taco chose. Dr. Dickhead said, hey, let's bring it down to your championship map, and he took him out on it. So GG's, really awesome game. This means that Dr. Dickhead will have the second to last choice of draft spot, and Surf Taco will have whatever is left in the draft order. So the very next match that we got to get into for you guys is Sand Rooster, Bohemian Rhapsody, and Turambar and the Fire Ferrets. Let's jump into it. All right, guys, and before we jump into this game, I want to go over something really quickly with you guys. First of all, Turambar and Sand Rooster are guildmates. Turambar is actually the guild leader of Get Schwifty. And these two players, because they are fighting over the fifth and sixth total, you know, draft choice, they, I don't think, saw that as like a huge advantage or disadvantage wherever they fall there. So they decided to do something kind of fun with their game. They decided to let the other person pick which three units they would have to bring, but it had to be exactly 220 cost for the team. So whatever the units are on this screen were chosen by the opposite team, but chosen by the opponent. So it should be interesting to get into. So it looks like Sand Rooster chose Engelbert, at least for Turambar, and Turambar chose Queen for Sand Rooster. So which units are in the battle here? It is Engelbert, Orlando, Luartha. So we haven't seen Luartha yet at all for Turambar. Sand Rooster says, hey, bring her out. Get the firing stance in order here. While it looks like for Sand Rooster is featuring Queen, Winter, Ravis, and Engelbert himself. So the Engelbert Wars. This could take a little while. This could be the tank wars, I think, that we're looking for. I will say, Winter Ravis we haven't seen a single time from Sand Rooster either, as she gets her three-hit barrier online. Crest of the Black Lion comes out from Orlando, so he's got AP Restore as well as a bunch of other buffs here. Engelbert getting his own Courage, his hate up, nullifying some status effects. And we're going to see the exact same thing from this Engelbert. I'm very curious to see who can carve through the Engelberts. One thing I will say is that Queen is a very flexible unit. She actually can be built as a mage, so I'm curious to see how Sand Rooster built her, whether it'll be physical or magical or a hybrid. Decent damage coming off from the Limb Break and lands the Frostbite on both units. That's actually pretty major, as the Black Rose Helena TMR comes out from Queen. And Bells from Luartha, so she actually cannot get in range to do damage. One of the probably few times where the Gunner sub job actually pays off for her because of that height range she's able to use Revitalize. Okay damage, also dropping Slash Tech Resist coming out from Turambar's Orlando, but he's basically out of AP now as Engelbert's going to walk up and kind of steal some health from him. Chakra comes out from the Engelbert with the Monk sub job popping regen. That is incredible. I've never seen that come out from Engelbert, and I absolutely love that. that's actually an insane tech, and I absolutely love that from Turnbar. Holy shit, though. The limit break from Queen gets her own haste online and almost popped Engelbert in one hit. Rapid release actually doing a decent amount to that Engelbert. I'm surprised she can even find that angle there as 3,000 damage comes out from the Ravies. Orlando with 0 AP, though, he's going to struggle. Actually, decent damage from the standard attack here, but I think Queen should be able to find an AoE. She goes Charge Johanna. That strike damage, 1913, is enough to bring the Courage on Engelbert, as well as some AoE damage on the other two units as well. Oh, man, this is so weird. All six units are in a tiny, tiny group of each other. I don't know if I've ever seen six units positioned just like this. They're all one big friendly hug, all in the same guild here. Dropping the Winter Ravies, that is now a 3v2 in Turambar's favor. This Loartha actually doing some damage here. Orlando can't quite pop the Courage from Engelbert, though. That early Frostbite just being so major here. This is a magic attack. Mafraidine, what is this going to do? I believe that is the AoE barrier break coming out from Queen. Pops the Courage on Engelbert. Honestly, Orlando needs to get some AP, though. I think the Frostbite is finally gone. Yes, it is, so he is now up to 21 AP. Three low health targets versus the Queen, the physical reflex. Oh man, does that end up mattering? I don't know if she would have died there. 5,900 damage, tough to say. I think she might have still had some hits from her barrier left, but Mafraidine, this is the AoE barrier break, going to drop two units. Orlando with 21 AP, another physical reflex. Oh my god. Yeah. I think those reflexes helped Sanders to win this. I'm not going to lie to you. Prey, magic attack coming out, 5,500 damage. He's going to win this game. GG's. Congratulations to Sanders on winning the friendly guild versus same guild battle here. Honestly, a really good fight. I do think those physical reflexes mattered. If she hit zero of those, she definitely loses. I don't know if either one would have won it, not entirely sure, but regardless, Sand Rooster wins the tiebreaker. So up to this point, it is one Heinler and one Rundall, and we'll have to see what happens in the next two. So the next game that we have is Machin X versus Ram 9. Let's jump into it. All right, guys, the third game that we've got going on here, we've got Ram 9 showing his Sevro and Machin X running the Sweetheart Ildira. We have not seen her from Machin X a single time this season. We saw McCrane put a ton of work in for her in the Heinler division, but we have not seen this yet, as Ravis and Miranda also coming with, and Ram 9 running Chunak, Ketone, Sevro. So a kind of a little evasion squad going here for Ram 9. I think he might have actually busted this out against Turambar in the final week. Subterfuge coming out from Sweetheart Ildira, Hate Down, as well as that nice little group AoE, and the Zombie Mask coming out from Ketone. So this is actually Planes 4, so it looks like Machin X with the point advantage just chose to run on Planes 4 instead of coming up with three maps. So this is a map switch up, as the first two maps were chosen by one of the opponents. Sweet support coming out, though. Again, that little of the bold TMR is just so strong. Having good agility can be the difference maker, especially when it gets late in fights as you start to lap people. A nice three-hit shield coming out from Sweetheart Ildira, though. And Sevro, this should be his job 120 skill. His job 25 skill, excuse me. Level 120 skill. I don't think he can reach for damage. So this will put haste and courage on himself as Ravi's buffs and moves towards the fight here. Miranda, probably a fast cast, as this has its own cast time. And couple turns probably before they actually start to meet each other. Although Ketone has tons of movement. Actually, not quite as much as I thought she did here. Haste Perpetuator comes out, so Sevro is online. He's ready to go. And the fast cast is so damn good now. Red Mage is just getting major job upgrades with that ability enhancement. Heart of Flutter using her own TMR here to get herself to move very quickly across the map. One thing I will say as this approaches here is that Miranda's, I think it's Dispelling Thrust, is a guaranteed hit with a ton of damage. Versus this evasion team, I think Miranda is the one to look out for, as Jamming Thrust comes out from Sevro, about 3k onto the Ravies. With the elemental disadvantage, honestly not bad at all, considering he's only 30 costs on our format. Miranda gonna walk forward, though. Can she find something? Yes, oh my goodness. Dispelling Thrust dispels his entire life bar there. Chunak is gone in one hit. What can Ketone do here? Saiga Shadowbind, hopefully going to land a stop in Ram 9's favor. 500, oh man, between the two hit chain, that only did 1400 damage, so even with the stop, that is not a lot. It's looking pretty rough for Ram 9 here. Sweetheart Ildira goes with the Toxic Assault, lands the poison, He's still got courage, though, so he's still going to live one hit. 72. No, he dies. I didn't know that interaction worked that way. Poison goes through courage. I learned something new today. Dispelling Thrust comes out, a ton of damage, and Inslee procs the courage on Katone. And Lordy, this is not a close fight. We've had two really, really close ones to start the day off, but it looks like Machin X is going to easily take this W. The Miranda and Sweetheart Eldira just putting in so much work, and we've seen this Ravi's at 60 cost just dumpstering people. I'm not even sure if this Ravi's is 140, actually. I didn't think to check right at the start of the fight, because these fights happened before. I think these fights happened a little while ago now, so it's hard to say when exactly that was, when she got her 140. I'm not entirely sure, but Katone, you could try your hardest, but you're going to have to get a massive Drain Force to even have a remote chance of winning this. And yeah, she's not running Drain Force. She goes for Paralyzing Edge. Should be Miranda. Can she get the kill? Toxic Assault lands, takes her out. A clean 3-0 victory for Machin X. And this game especially, I think, is where it kind of starts to matter who wins. For some of those other games, you know, with the Turin Bar and Sand Rooster, you know, Surf Taco Dr. Dickhead ones, you can argue how much it matters to win that game because of what your pick order matters. Like, having the choice between maybe the fifth pick or the sixth pick or something like that might not be a huge deal. But in this, the winner of this, who is Machin X, gets the third choice of draft pick. And in my opinion of what draft picks are stronger, this means that he can probably guarantee himself either the second overall pick or the last pick. And second overall is really good because it's early on, and last pick is good because you have a double turn there. So this is a pretty big win for Machin X here. GG's to both players though, and we've got one more banger game for you guys between the first seed of the Runnel division, Coppola, and the first seed of the Heinler division, McCrane. Let's jump into it. All right guys, our final game before we get into the draft recap here, we've got the McCrane's Flagbearer Glassy on the left side and Coppola running that Skahal. So my question is it Skahal Cloud Naya coming out from Coppola, or is he running something like that Raldor? We saw him do a splash like that, and I think in the final week here, McCrane going Flagbearer Glassy, Lemure, Naya, and it is that lightning comp coming out from Coppola. This lightning comp from Coppola has not lost a single game all season. Can it keep the undefeated streak alive against McCrane, who was undefeated in his series record all season? So, Zombie TMR coming out from Skahal, Keenblade coming out from Cloud, getting that CT up, and Naya in the back with heals. Flagbearer Glassy going to go with her AoE buff that gives herself a physical and magical shield along with some accuracy and some other things. Naya, can she get in reach to pop a regen? She actually goes for sweet support, so agility buff up. Coppola loves to run those CT up and speed agility up type TMRs. Lemure should be able to get a haste of jaw off, as I think this Naya probably goes for a regen. No, sweet support. It is the exact same thing on both sides. Both players knowing exactly how to run this Naya. And haste on the entire team could be pretty effective. My biggest question is, how much damage can Flagbearer Glassy get off quickly? My concern is that with Skahal having to take basically three hits to die, Lemure is going to have to be somewhat offensive, which we have seen from McCrane before. We're going to need, because the thing is, like, getting through Skahal, especially with a healer, you almost need two different people doing damage at the same time. So we'll see what happens here. Lemure going to go Grace of Eternal Friendship. Should move forward as well. No, yeah, she does. I was going to say, I think her AI moves forward after she buffs. Not exactly like a lot of other support units. Naya's going to channel something for herself. And this, I imagine, is probably regen at this moment. Shell coming on. So that is another way to further mitigate the damage coming out from Skahal, because he is a powerhouse. What does he go for here? Is this a Flare or a Thundaga? Cloud should be able to get in range as well, I think. Lemure kind of out in the middle of nowhere. Ascension comes through. How much damage is this going to do? 78, 30, does that one shot? Yes, it does. Skahal, did he go for Lemure specifically, though? Because if so, this could miss. And the Reflect coming out on Skahal. Interesting. Yeah, Flare is going to whiff. So the big thing here is, though, I think Naya should be able to get a full life off in time. What can Flagbearer Glassy do, though, in the middle of this? Shining Conviction does a ton. Instantly procs the Courage from Skahal. But again, you have to hit him again. And Naya, looking at the turnover, is probably going to get a heal off pretty soon. But this full life comes out. Where is Lemure in the turn order? She's not for a while, actually. Debilitating counter doing very little to Flagbearer Glassy. as, wow, she actually laps, gets the kill before Naya can get any sort of heal off. That's pretty major because now the re-raise is down. McCrane kind of out to an early lead here, but the turn order is going to be rough because this is going to be a heal into Skahal and Cloud right in a row. Sweet support, just another refresh. Does that change the turn order on the left side? It does not look like it. Nothing seems to change here. Skahal, I imagine this is a Thundaga. He's not going to move at all. And Cloud going to go next, probably triple slash. No, goes for the stun blade. Does not go for the AoE. Must not have had the damage to take out Lemuria from triple slash, I'm thinking, unless he didn't have the AP. But I think he did. Kiriga comes out, Thundaga, how much? 1408. My god, Flagbearer Glassy is just built different. It's insane to me. Another debilitating counter. Nerfing her damage a little bit, but it doesn't show as he has instantly popped the one health again. What is the turn order? Skahal's going to go next, and then it's going to be McCrane's Naya. These double Nayas, a little bit confusing. Two OP units, honestly the MVP of both. Wow, both divisions all season. Flagbearer Glassy is just barely hanging on. And now here's the main concern. Does this heal land before Cloud goes? No, Cloud's going to go next. That is major because now she's going to drop. This Kiriga is going to whiff and I'm... Oh no, the re-raise. I forgot. Re-raise went off. So maybe this heal actually will land. But another heal from this Naya. And it's one of those things that Coppola is just slightly ahead right now because Naya can't waste a turn going for a full life. Skahal's going to go for more damage here. I think this takes her out. 41-26, not quite. Man, looking at the turn order again, a Glassy and then another Naya. So now the question is, just like the last turn, can Naya get this heal off before anyone else goes? You know what? I keep thinking blue Naya is on the left side for McCrane. It's actually for Coppola. What does Naya go for here? She goes for the heal. Does she get it off in time? She did not get it off last time. She's not going to get it off this time either. Coppola's going to walk up, hit her in the mouth. She is going to drop, and you have to imagine this is GG's. She does have two full life casts on her, but I can't imagine she's going to get an opportunity to do that. Skahal's going to go for an attack here. Magic Reflex. I forgot that existed on Naya. If there wasn't too much already in her kit, she also has Magic Reflex. There's no way, man. She's going to get another turn here. There's no way she gets a full life off, is there? What does she go for? She starts channeling. I don't think so. Cloud's easily going to kill her in one hit. 10,000 damage. And a clean victory coming out from Coppola. The Naya Wars, the favor goes to Coppola here in this best of one. So that means Coppola will have his choice of where he wants to draft. So he will have the first choice, and then it will be McCrane, Machin X, Ram 9, Sand Rooster, Turambar, Dr. Dickhead, Surf Taco. In that order, those players will get to choose where they want to be in the draft order. That being said, I hope you guys enjoyed the games. It's time to get into the draft recap, and I'll talk a little bit about who chose to be where in the draft. I'll go over the ban phase, which is something new to it, and then I'll go over the rosters. Let's jump into those. All right, guys, so now to jump into the draft here, and I do apologize. I did not make a graphic for each draft round. Personally, it takes a lot of extra time, and I think this clearly enough shows who was taken. And I just kind of want to go over some of this stuff really briefly with you guys, and then I'm going to take more time to actually further analyze each team's final draft. I think it's a little more interesting that way, just to see how the teams match up or, you know, kind of filled themselves out. But first of all, before we go over what the picks were, like I said, Coppola had his choice of where he wanted to draft. He chose the first overall spot, as you can see here. McCrane had his second choice of the draft, so this is, in my opinion, where there actually is kind of a potential difference of where you want to be. McCrane chose the second overall pick. He decided earlier in the draft, getting a power pick right off the gate was more advantageous. The third choice was Machin X, and you're going to see his name way down here. He chose the eighth overall pick, which in this draft is the final pick. And the reason you choose the last pick is because this is a snake draft. It goes 1 through 8 and then 8 through 1. So he is essentially able to pick two picks in a row for each turn. So in my opinion, I think this was actually a really good decision by him. I actually loved being the final pick of our original draft this season, and I think it's just a really good choice. The fourth choice was Ram 9. He went with the third pick. Sand Rooster was fifth choice. He went through the fourth pick. So up to this point, out of the first five picks, everybody basically went the highest pick available other than Machen X. But I do like the decision from Machen X. Turnbar had the sixth overall choice. He went with pick seven. So even though he could have taken pick five or six, been a little earlier in the round, he decided that being closer to the end of the draft is more advantageous, which I think I agree with personally, because there's just less time in between your one of your picks, and you're more likely to be able to pair picks together that you like to have. The last two final choices came to Dr. Dickhead. He went with that same process, took the sixth overall selection, and the final pick that was left over was Surf Taco, and he got stuck with five. That being said, looking at these picks, just to run through this first round before we get into it, I want to talk about the ban phase. Now, this is something that we introduced for the playoffs. This is not something that we've done before, but because there were only eight players in this draft rather than 10, we thought that some of the stuff might be a little too OP. We've seen certain units just absolutely crush, like certain units like Naya or something like that. And we wanted the players to have an opportunity to ban units that they thought would be a problem. Now, the rules on how we did this was we did two blind community bans, essentially. Now, how this worked was we had everybody in the league, so both divisions of whether you made playoffs or not, submit their top three units that they think should be banned from the playoffs. And the top two vote getters, regardless, would be banned. And now the top two vote getters from all of the units were number one in a landslide victory was Naya. She got a vote from almost every player in the league. I think she got like 17 votes or 16 votes, something like that. And the second, I think actually was a little surprising to me, but was Flagbearer Glassy. So as you can see, McCrane, who was undefeated throughout the regular season up until this game versus Coppola, his two power picks actually were banned before the draft even started. The other restriction that we did, or the next step of the ban phase, was essentially to start with the final pick of the draft, which in this case would be Machen X, and work backwards all the way up to Coppola. And each player would get to pick one unit that they want banned from the playoff draft. We did cap each tier at a set number of bans, which essentially made each tier a total of only four bans could happen. So Naya and Flagbearer Glassy were already off the board, and then a bunch of other bans took place, and I'll go over those bans really quickly with you. So as you can see, these are the bans right here. Machen X chose to ban Skahal. Turnbar banned Little Leela, the SR unit. Dr. Dickhead banned Celis. Surf Taco banned Starlight Elena. Sand Rooster banned Valade, who recently got his 140 upgrade. Ram9 and the Rock Boys banned Ravis. McCrane banned Sakura. And Coppola banned Warrior of Light. So those are essentially the 10 bans that happened before the draft started. Other than that, the format is essentially the same as our original draft. You get three tier 1 units, three tier 2s, three tier 3s, and a flex. And then after all 10 rounds are over, we're allowing everyone else to ban one or to choose one more unit for their team, regardless of cost. But again, that has to be specifically in the 11th round. So you basically get two flexes, but one of them can't be picked until the final pick. So to jump back into this, these are the first six rounds of picks for you guys, and I kind of want to just dive into certain picks that I find interesting or that I think are really, really good. And then after this, I will go to look at the final rosters, which I did make graphics for, and we can kind of talk about those a little bit. So first of all, with the power picks of 40 costers being banned, the first overall pick was Slime by Coppola. And in our format, Slime is 50 costs, not 20. So he's not as much of a no-brainer, but in my opinion, this is still a very, very good first overall pick. I think there's an argument for a handful of units, but he is definitely in the conversation. Sand Rooster, pick number 4, Jaden Rundahl. I think this is also a fantastic pick. We have seen in both Season 1 and Season 2, whoever has Jaden has just put in so much work with him. You know, in a lot of like the arena scene and stuff like that, Jaden might not be seen as often, but I think that's because some of the newer units just have ways to deal with him. In this format, a lot of times you don't have a way to deal with him, and especially depending on the map, he can be super oppressive. That being said, there's a few more picks in this round that I think were really, really good. Probably my favorite pick of the entire first round is Miranda by Surf Taco, our defending Season 1 champion here. And he might have just barely squeaked into the playoffs in the final week, and he had the last choice of draft pick spot here. I think he might have the best pick in the first round. Miranda at 70 cost in our format is absolutely bananas. We saw how much damage Machin X was allowed to do in that final week. We saw Ram 9 put a ton of work in with her. She has Time Mage support, she has Courage, she has Fast Cast, she has guaranteed hit, tons of damage. I mean, she's got everything you could possibly want for 70 cost, and a big water player in Surf Taco, I think this is an excellent choice. Lucia Halloween, another really big shout out to me. I think this is a fantastic choice by Turambar in the first round. I think she's totally worthy of 100 cost, in my opinion. So to grab her at 90 in the first round is great. And the other big, big pick that I think I was shocked made it all the way to the end of the first round is Zazan. Zazan did not get banned, our 20 cost unit. He is one of only two units in the entire format with 20 cost, and he is the only Keenblade user at 20 cost. We have seen Dr. Dickhead do a lot of work with Zazan, and we saw even more so Sand Rooster with his double Jaden comp with Zazan Keenblade strategies just work absolute wonders. So I think that was a very smart choice. So honestly, the first round, I don't think there's a single bad choice here. Passaro is good. Perrine is really good. Engelbert's a very solid 70 cost, like just getting a nice value there. I mean, all the way down the board, first round was very, very good in my opinion. The second round, Oberon from Machin X makes sense to grab another 100 cost unit to go with the Zazan. Glacella is probably the best 80 cost in the format, so Turambar grabs just another good unit for the value. Phoebe, a very solid support unit for Dr. Dickhead here. Surf Taco grabbing Cyrell. I'll say, when I looked here after the first two rounds, I thought the winner of the draft was Surf Taco. I just really felt like that after the first two rounds. I think he has the best 50 cost unit in our format in Cyrell, and the best 70 cost unit in Miranda. And just with that start, I think his start is absolutely disgusting. And the fact that the 4 seed from Rundle had this kind of start, I just think his team is going to be scary for whoever faces him. Going on from there though, Whisper, a very smart choice by Sandrooster, 70 cost, banger. Victoria, same thing. Gargus, same thing. All those units are really good at 70. And Coppola picked his absolute stud, Lucio, to end that second round. So from here, I'm not going to go through all the picks. I wanted to really try and highlight those first couple picks or first couple rounds because I think they're really, really interesting. But maybe just to throw a couple of spotlights on any picks that stand out to me. Machin X at the end of the third and fourth round was able to grab Aliyah and Eliza together. That double missile comp I think is very, very interesting. Surf Taco grabbing Astrius, his season one hero here. Ram 9 grabbing Kilfey, who put in a ton of work for him this season. I like the Severo pick by McCrane. I think he is easily the best 30 cost unit in our format. I think Sylvie is a really good option by Sandrooster here, just as a really strong light unit in the third round, or fourth round, excuse me. And for Coppola, Garvel. Garvel is an absolute stud at 80, especially considered he also has Dark Fina. So if he gets a 40 cost unit later in the draft, two, you know, like double Dark Magics, very, very strong here. Looking at the fifth and sixth round here, any sort of picks that stand out to me. I like this Little Leela the Bold. Or actually, I think this is Little Leela Halloween, so I do like this pick as well. Even at 80 cost, I think she's really strong. The Katia pick is very interesting to me by McCrane. We have not seen Katia at all in either season, and to grab her in the fifth round, I think is actually kind of smart by McCrane. I think he will probably use her as like a healer. She also has that upgrade from the cleric job, so it is now like a one-hit barrier for her team, which could be really, really nice. I like the Aerith pick by Turambar. He has shown to put in a lot of work with her, and Surf Taco did the same thing with her. I think Uni is good to give flexibility. Orlando is really solid at 80 cost. Honestly, I mean, not a lot to critique here on most of these drafts. And I think those are probably the interesting ones to me in the fifth and sixth round. Jumping into the last couple rounds here, Mont King of Leonis for Coppola at 90 cost is really, really solid. I love the Marial pick as a low-cost tank option. Lightning, I think this is fantastic. Well, I'll go over the draft and, you know, his team to see what he can synergize with. Me personally, Lightning was the hard carry of my team throughout the entire season, so getting her this late in the draft, I think she's slept on. I think she is much better than this. Rabies, I think, is a sensational pick this late in the draft. Joker, a really, really good pick by Turambar here. I think bringing out one of his season one, you know, MVPs. Again,
just slept on at 90 cost. Really, really good. McCrane grabbing Cloud this late, I think, is a steal. And then the final couple rounds here. I mean, Agrius is really good to pick up late. Fryavia is bananas to pick up late. Let me see here what else I like. Luel, I absolutely love this pick late. I absolutely love the Titus pick by Dr. Dickhead as well. I think he is a stud at 50 cost this late. Honestly, a ton of really good picks throughout the draft. I think all eight teams did a sensational job. I think it's time to break down the rosters and see what every team looks like. All right, guys, so let's break down some of these rosters going into the playoffs here and just take a look at what the final teams look like. And I will say a few of the teams did change their names, so just as a heads up, but I will go over that as we go. So let's start with the first overall pick, and that's going to be Coppola of the Guild Galleon, coach of the Gnostics. Obviously, got his poster boy, Lucio, one of his really, really solid units from earlier this season. Taking a look at this team, one thing that I will kind of say or shout out, I don't think this team is as good as his regular season team, but I don't know how he possibly could have drafted something as good as his regular season team. His regular season was absolutely bananas. I mean, the only series loss he had was against to Surf Taco, which I think Little Leela kind of hard countered his team there. But some interesting stuff here. First of all, one glaring pick here, Thancred at 90 cost. I know a lot of people watching this are probably going to think Thancred isn't worth 90 cost. I have seen Coppola personally, like firsthand, put in work with Thancred in a top 8 draft format on Orange's Friday Night Fights and make him look like an absolute god. If there's any player out there that can make Thancred look really good, it is this guy right here. So I'm not disrespecting this pick. He can make him look like a stud, guaranteed, I promise. Darkfina, Garvel are a really interesting combo to me to pair up with the Socia here. Slime is really good just to pair up with any 90-80 combo. So, like, he has multiple options here. He can run Mont King of Leonis with Slime plus insert 80 cost damage dealer. Lucio, Orlando, Garvel, Agrius, you know, like, any one of those units can pair. And honestly, Mont King of Leonis with Slime sounds like a real freaking pain to get through. That sounds like an absolute massive wall and not something that I would want to deal with. I like the fact that he can run Fina along with a couple of 80 cost units, so he still has, you know, some missiles, some range support, some full life, some more heals. Honestly, it's an interesting team. I'll be straight out and say, one thing real quick, actually, I do really like, I want to point out this pick down here. Salir Sweetheart, 90 cost, glove synergy along with Garvel, and you can run basically a glove team with Garvel, Salir Sweetheart, and Slime. That fits the 220 cost limit, and Slime fits with glove cards, and there's actually a decent amount of glove cards right now, so the fact that you could run those three units together, I actually think that's a really good option as well. What I will say, I think this team is middle of the pack in terms of the eight teams, like just on a roster perspective. But Coppola is such a good player that I will not be shocked at all if he ends up in going to win the tournament somehow anyway. Like, if I had to rate just like all the teams on how good I think the rosters are, I think this is middle of the pack. But like I said, he is outstanding. So we'll have to see what he goes and does with it. He is facing Dr. Dickhead in the first round, so it should be an interesting matchup. We'll go over his team in a little bit. Let's go ahead and jump into the second overall pick, which is McCrane of the Guild Hydra, coach of the Materia Hunters. He had a perfect record, or at least a perfect series record, throughout the regular season. Unfortunately, did drop that best of one to Coppola, so had the second overall pick rather than the first. But I don't think that stopped him from drafting an outstanding team here. So a couple of things to shout out real quick, just glaringly obvious strong teams. Ester and Cloud can pair up together with Severo. I think this is insane. You can either run some hate on Estro if you want to run a tank, because I personally think Cloud is a really good unit that can run, you know, a lot of different situations, but he's best behind somebody with some hate because his AoE resist is just incredible. But you can either run some hate on Ester, or you can literally give Severo a bow tie, get him to use his own courage ability, and if it's a long enough map, you might even be able to get him to use like re-raise, and now he is taking like three hits worth of tankiness, and by that time, if you have Ester and Cloud with three turns, like, or, you know, multiple turns of damage, that other team is probably just dead. So I like the Ester Cloud Severo pairing. I like the Pissarro pick. One thing I will shout out is that he has a lot of different elements here. He has fire, wind, ice, earth, lightning, like he's got light, he's all over the board. This is one team or one player that I think did this to tremendous success throughout the season. I looked at his original team and I placed him fifth in the Heimler division. That was a massive mistake by me, because I think I just underrated how well he could, you know, pair some of those units together, and I expect to see more of that going forward. He has four 70 cost units, which is really nice because he can do a full UR team with Gargus, Lastwall, Moraga, and Yurma. Pick any three of those. Those are very, very solid options. He can run one of his 90s with Solier and a 70. So you could run something like Cloud, Solier, Gargus, running like Dark Ramu in the party. I think that gives a lot of really nice options. You can run the damage of Cloud, Solier with Moraga tanking for you guys. I like the Katia pick because it is a low cost healer, and I think a lot of people didn't really look that way, but I'm excited to see like how he uses her as a heal support. Several brings a lot of pain at 30. And even if you didn't want the Moraga, like, you know, being an outstanding physical tank, now you have a magic tank in Marial. So you have both options here, both physical and magic. So just looking at this team top to bottom, I really don't think there's much to dislike. I think he did a fantastic job. Again, I don't think it's as strong as a season, you know, regular season team is, but I think that's just not having Naya. I think Naya is incredible. Other than that, I think he did an outstanding job. And he didn't get an opportunity to get Naya. So what are you going to do? His team looks really, really good. Would not be surprised to see him succeed in the playoffs. Third team to go through here is Ram 9 of the Guild Howl, coach of the Rock Boys here. And looking at the roster, a couple of things that I really like. Immediately, he has a pairing that Jebba and the Sappers actually had this season, which is Perrine, Victora, Ramada. And this is one of the only teams that Jebba was actually able to bring out and get wins with, because we did see it was a pretty strong team. It has a couple of different synergies. It has some pierce synergy. It has the Dark Odin synergy with that water and ice like physical unit stuff. So I really, really like that aspect. I also love the fact that he grabbed multiple 80s and 70s. He can grab Victora Kilfey and run it with either Raldor, Fryevia, or Velric, just completely dependent on what he wants in that third unit. We saw him do a ton of work with triple UR combos throughout the season. I would not be shocked at all to see him do that again. That being said, he also has a couple of options where he could run something like one of these 90 cost units, a 70 cost unit, and Shell as a time mage. This is something that we saw Surf Taco do a lot of work with in the first season. So you could have somebody like Victora running the Kane TMR with Dragoon's Pride, getting haste on herself. You run either Urel or Renan in slot one, use Shell to haste one of them, and then drop Quickens. So now you have two really solid damage dealers who are already hasted and Quickens coming through. You might be able to just melt through the other team very, very quickly. From the bottom here, I like the Surge as 30 cost pick just for the simple fact that now you can run, you know, something like Perrine and Renan or Perrine and Urel if you want to. It just ultimately gives you some flexibility. Again, really, really solid team. Not much to critique here. I like the, you know, kind of strong ice play he's got going. But grabbing Perrine is also really nice because it deters a lot of that fire that might potentially try and come out and beat it. And fourth overall pick here is Sandrooster of the Guild Get Schwifty. Ended up changing his team name to the Hidden Village of Regret. The Rundall third seed grabs a ton, like I literally mean a ton, of light and dark units. You can very, very easily see this is the strategy he was trying to run. I want to give a quick reminder to everybody, you can only run two of the same elements in a party. You can't do full light or full dark, so he cannot do that, just so you know. But that is kind of a strategy that he tried to run. So first of all, he's got two strong light 100 costers and two strong dark 100 costers. He's got Jaden Rundall, Sylvie, Little Eelable, and Shadowlinks on Ice. He did not grab Mia, so he cannot run both of them all at the same time, but he's got a Pierce attacker, he's got a really strong Slash attacker, he's got a really strong missile unit, and a really, really good support. So he has like a 100 cost unit of light or dark that basically fits whatever the hell he needs it to do. He's got a 70 cost tank, he's got a 70 cost Slash evade unit, and a 70 cost magic damage support. So you can see he's running a 100, a 70, and a 50. Basically, that's how he structured his team with his cost limits. I just really, really like the way he did this. I think it's nice to look at, just seeing a, hey, I pick a 100, I pick a 70, and I pick a 50. I think this is a really smart move by him. As for the 50 cost units, I think he has some really, really solid ones. Shadowlinks is an absolute beast. Shutzel, I love this pick. I cannot tell you guys. I use Shutzel in PvP like all the time. Just for fun. Like, he's not best unit in the game or anything like that. I'm not trying to say that. but he gets absolutely absurd levels of penetration. His slash resist penetration without even remotely trying can hit 100, like no problem at all. If you're running the Esther VC, I think that gives 30 or 35. He gets 40 from his knight subjob, and you run the Esther sword. Bang, done, 100 slash pen without even thinking about it. It's absolutely insane. He has a skill with 40% chance to stop in a big, not a big, but a somewhat large AoE like cross shape that also gives him 50 defense pen on the attack. He might be 50 cost unit, but he literally hits like an absolute truck. So I'm excited to see use coming out from Shutzelt, and I'm excited to see how he uses Livial and Ryryu, two units that we really didn't get to see play from, but it should be interesting. Honestly, if I'm ranking teams, this is also one of those teams right near the top. I think an exceptional job from Sand Rooster here. So now the latter half of the draft, the fifth overall pick. And like I said, I thought what was probably the best pick in the draft is the Miranda here with the new name change from the Superines. No longer has Perine, so he's got to kind of change it up. Earth, Wind, and Fire, and Water. But he's stuck with his musical theme, basically, of he had the Ed Sheerans in Season 1, and now he's going with Earth, Wind, and Fire. Miranda, absolutely excellent at 70 cost unit. He can run Miranda, Astrea, Cyrell. I can't even explain how scary that team is. That team is just going to dumpster people. There's so much damage there, along with Miranda, like Time Age support and stuff like that. You've got double courage online. Cyrell can get crazy bulky. That is really terrifying. Also, if you don't want to run Astrea, you can choose to run Summer Jaden instead with Miranda and Cyrell. And like just those two teams alone, without even looking at the other options he has here, which he has a ton, I think is just insane. He has double fire missile that he can run with Sedia and Luartha with the tank Dario. He can run freaking double wind kind of missile teams or magic teams with Summer Jaden, More the Merrier, Uni. This team has like so many options I can't even explain. That I don't know if this is my number one favorite team, but it is either number one or number two probably. I keep thinking, I'm like, dude, this guy squeaked in the playoffs and there's a very real chance this guy just runs over it and wins the whole thing. This team looks so damn good. I don't know if he thinks it as good as I do, but I think it is really scary. I just have very little to comment on or say that's bad about this team. The only thing that is a little scary is he plays against McCrane in the first round, who is a very good player who also has a top tier team and has a lot of lightning threats. But just because of that, he grabbed Mashiri, Queen of Horn, just in case he runs into some of that lightning stuff. So exceptional job by Surf Taco here. He is going to try and defend his title from Season 1. We'll see if he can do it again in Season 2. Three more teams to look at here. Here's the Heinler 4th seed, and this is the final name change for the team. Went from the Foolish Mortals now to Problematic Name. This is Dr. Dickhead of the Guild Lapis. And looking at this team here, a couple of things. So first of all, grabbing Dwayne somewhat early. I actually love this pick here. Dwayne was not chosen in either Season 1 or Season 2, and for good reason. Season 1, he was 100 cost in our format, was not very strong at the time. This season, he was 90 cost, but again, he hadn't received an MA2 or, you know, a 140 or anything like that. Now with his new vision card and his 140, I think he's slept on. I think he's actually a really solid unit, especially in this format. He can remove re-raise, he can remove courage, he has dark resist down, he has just a lot going in his kit. And he didn't grab any 100 cost units other than his final pick, which is Regalia Glacella. We'll have to see how she pans out. I don't think she is the most impressive unit in the world, but she can do some damage. We did see that from Unhindered in Season 1. That being said, though, some pairings that I think he did that I do like, you know, quite a bit here. He can go with any one of these 90 cost units along with Engelbert and Phoebe or Curry. I like the 90-70-60 pairing. I do like the fact that he can run Little Leela Halloween here along with one of these 90s and Titus. I think I probably like that even more, I would say, just because you have a damage dealer support with a tank and insert other 90 costs here. My favorite pick of the entire draft here for him, based on where he chose it, was Lightning. My only question here is, what else is he running with it? That would at least be my first thought. But honestly, like, there were multiple times during the season, like, my most common team that I ran Lightning with was two random dark units in Garvel and Titus that really don't seem to have synergy. It just didn't matter. Lightning just does so much damage that, like, at first I was thinking, oh, what is he going to run with? I don't think it matters. I think she's just that good. that she can just absolutely put in work. Summer Elsie, another unit that is probably better than I originally gave it credit for. We saw Surf Taco put in a lot of work with her. And he's just kind of all over the board here with different elements and different types of units and stuff like that. Curious to see what he runs here. I will say, if I had to rank all the teams in just terms of what their roster is, I think I would have this on the lower side, but I really hope I'm wrong, and I really hope to see some success coming out from Dr. Dickhead. He's got his work cut out for him as he plays Coppola in the first round. So good luck, man. I hope you do well in your series. We've got two more teams to look at here. Turambar, the Fire Ferrets, the Season 1 regular season winner and the runner-up in the championship of Season 1. He is back to try and claim what he couldn't in Season 1 here. So of the guild, get Schwifty, Fire Ferrets, rocking that Aerith again, just like earlier in the season. Absolutely love what he did here. Very similar to Dr. Dickhead, didn't grab a single 100 cost unit until his final pick, which is Ibarra, which can bring a lot of pain and just, I don't know, she just does a ton of damage, which is really nice. A couple of the teams, though, that I think are just absolutely fantastic for him. He can run Lucia Halloween, Joker, and Murmur. That team will not take damage from physical, or at least Lucia Halloween's not going to. She's going to have a barrier. She's going to have AoE resist. She's going to have protect from Joker. That team is going to do a lot of damage. Murmur is bulky. I really like that setup a lot. I like Snow as a self-healing, you know, like physical tank damage dealer. You can run Snow along with McCloud. Honestly, if you run Snow McCloud, though, I'm not sure who else you run there other than maybe like Adelard, so maybe you don't run that, now that I'm thinking about that. But what you can do, I think a really strong team, is Glacella Aerith McCloud. A couple of Dark Odin, you know, spear users, damage dealers, you can run spear-based job cards together along with Aerith support in the back. I think Luel is just a fantastic 80 cost unit. So I'll be curious to see what he does here. I think the most obvious is a 90-90 plus Murmur. 90-80 plus Adelard, 80-80 plus McCloud, but he has a number of different options that he can go with. I think a very solid team. I love the Lucia Halloween pick. I will say, in terms of overall strength of the team, I think this is another right in the middle, if I had to guess. I think he's probably about 4th, 5th in terms of absolute like roster strength. But similarly to what I said to Coppola, an exceptional player. So could he succeed or exceed those expectations? Absolutely. Would not be surprised at all. And the final team to go through is Machen X's team of the Guild Lucis. And the team name actually changed to Shoopuff's Playoffs, which I think is hilarious. It was Shoopuff's Sweetheart in parentheses, but he changed to Playoff version because now he's in the playoffs. I think this is absolutely hilarious. So the team he built, though, is really, really strong. First of all, he grabbed Zazan with the first overall pick, which just opens up a ton of flexibility. He did a lot of cold triangle stuff here with the Earth, Ice, and Water comps. And he can run stuff like Oberon, Heinler, Zazan the Unkillable plus Zazan. He can run Aliyah, Rundall, and Eliza. He can run Aliyah and Zoma. So he has double like high-cost ice or earth that he can run with that Zazan, opening up a lot of flexibility here. He can also run either Lorenzo or Nasha with Ravis Winter plus insert 90 cost, which is just absolutely insane to me. Well, he can't technically run triple ice, but you guys understand what I'm saying. So he could run something like Ravi's Winter Lorenzo Zoma or Ravi's Winter Eliza Lorenzo. I think either one of those options are solid. He can't do triple UR, unfortunately, but he can run something like Ketone Ildira plus one of those 60 cost units. I think it's really, really strong. He's got a lot of really good missile, which we've seen is very effective in the WDL. We saw him put in work with Oberon and Aliyah near the end of the regular season, and that was with Mia. Zazan is just basically an upgrade over Mia straight up, so excited to see what he can do with that team as well. Ravi's Winter used in a ice player's hands I think is even scarier, because we saw her do some work early, but mostly it was in rainbow compositions and not in somebody who plays ice a lot, which he does. So I'm excited to see how it works out, but it should be a good time. I think a lot of these teams look really, really strong. I don't know. I think this is probably, again, maybe third-ish. I feel like most teams are probably hovering right around the same strength if I had to give it. But I think he has a very legitimate chance against anybody he goes up against. All right, guys, and that is going to do it for the roster rundowns. I hope you guys enjoyed this draft recap video. I know it was a little different than one of them that I, you know, normally do. I didn't go through every single pick or anything like that, but I think this was probably a long enough video and I didn't need to do that for you guys. So taking a look at the quick playoff bracket here, we've got McCrane and the Materia Hunters versus Surf Taco and Earth, Wind, and Fire. The winner of that plays the winner of the Shoe Puffs playoffs, Mage Nexus team, and Turnbar of the Fire Ferrets. So honestly, right off the gate, these are some really, really hype matchups, and it doesn't get any less hype in the bottom side. We've got Coppola of the Gnostics versus Dr. Dickhead of Problematic Name, Ram9 of the Rock Boys versus Sand Rooster of Hidden Village of Regret. I hope you guys enjoyed watching this video. I hope you guys look forward to the other Toilet Bowl matches and also the playoff matches coming up. Should be a good time. You guys have a wonderful day.